Burgandy Williams, the R&B powerhouse, is an Atlanta, Georgia native coming from a long line of singers. Burgandy attended the prestigious North Atlanta High School of Performing Arts, where her formal training began. She has sung for foreign consulates in Paris, Korea, and Kuwait, and has also had feature roles in theatrical shows like The King of Glory and Jesus Christ Superstar Gospel. Burgandy is open for Babyface in concert. Now, after a very competitive run on the UK's smash hit X Factor, Burgandy returned to the U.S. and is an Apollo Theater regular. These days, she has turned her sights to the lights of Broadway. Watch out for this rising star.
Upward and Onward presents our Meeting at the Crossroads music series.
So how are you, sweetie? I'm so glad that you joined us for our Meeting at the Crossroads with Upward and Onward Presents. It's such a pleasure. I literally like, what's going on over there? You haven't...
Wardrobe malfunctions.
Where are you from?
I'm from Atlanta.
What part?
I'm from the SWAT. Baby, what you know about the A?
Because I'm from the A. All day. What high school you go to?
Why do I feel like I knew this about you?
What high school you go to?
North Atlanta.
Oh, okay. That's where I went. I just wondered where you...
You lied.
You have done some great and amazing things. Some astonishing things. And
really?
I mean, you as a powerhouse as a vocalist, and some of your experiences are like not of the norm. So I kind of want to speak about a few of those things, but I want to first, introduce you to the folks out there and welcome you into our world. Talk to me about your life, because you've been a soldier, you sold pizza, you've done everything. Like I'm trying to do my research, but I'm like, the soldier thing had me because I started off in, and this is nowhere near what you went through, but I started off in high school as an ROTC person, thinking that I was going to go into the armed forces years later.
Okay, so I was in the Army 8 years, collectively, Army Reserve and the Army, active Army. I, too, was in ROTC at said high school.
Crazy.
Okay. I'm blown away right now. But we're going to go back. So, I don't know. Life in the Army is different for everybody.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I had a hard time. Hard time. Because I didn't want to be there or I wasn't motivated, because I was at ROTC. They was like, let me tell you, I got in trouble so much. They'd be like, William, every time I see your teeth, drop and give me 10. I was like, man, So the first sergeant would call my name and they'd be like, Williams. I'm like, huh? Yes, sir, sergeant. He's like, drop. I'm like, oh.
There you go. You're like, damn it. You done set me up. Now, where were you stationed? Where were you stationed at?
I've been in Fort Jackson, Fort Hood, Camp Casey in Kuwait. Camp Casey in Korea. Camp Doha in Kuwait, and Fort McPherson in Atlanta.
Fort McPherson, where Tyler Perry took it over and said, we're going to turn this
took it over. It's Tyler Perry City now.
Yeah. And with your start to music was basically, I guess, through school, through high school. Now, was Rooster Stokes one of your mentors going into everything?
It was Daryl. Daryl Mitchell.
Daryl Mitchell.
Daryl Mitchell. Was my mentor and
with the list with the braces. Did he have the braces there?
Yeah, he had the braces. Oh yes. Oh my God. Yeah, that was the leader right there. He really pulled something out of me because I was very timid singer in high school.
Okay.
I was a soprano but refused to sing soprano because I didn't want to stand out. So I grew up telling everybody I was an alto. And he's like, no, you're a soprano. And I fought him for a year. I'm not a soprano. I'm not a soprano. And then finally, when it was finally my time to be able to audition, because Billy had left.
Yeah.
He was like, I'll let you in, but you got to sing soprano.
He was like, damn it.
Right. My name is Burgandy Williams. I'm from Atlanta, but I live in London. And just absolutely loving it. Killing it. Didn't happen. I've had more jobs than you could possibly imagine. I've delivered pizzas, phone books, newspapers. I've been a soldier, an actual map maker. I've worked for the government, unofficial masseuse. What were we talking about?
How did you and Kwame meet?
We met singing with, wait, who sent me to you?
Was it Darnell? Darnell White? Yeah, okay.
Darnell, I met Kwame through Darnell, and then it turns out we had other friends in common.
See, and like, once
you meet him, how can you not love him?
Come on.
When did you start singing? Like what inspired you to start singing and performing?
So I was always around music. I didn't grow up in a church per se, but I grew up around music all the time. And when we did go to church, the only reason I stayed awake was because the choir was there. The choir was gone, I was asleep. And then, you know, all through middle school, high school, I tried to join the Army choir, but someone weighed too much, so I was flat all the time.
You have to be under a certain amount of pounds to be in the Army choir?
To be in anything. So in the Army, they'll take you and they'll mold you into what they can.
Right.
So my body was way more dense, more muscle. I was into weightlifting in high school. So I didn't meet the height weight requirement. So I was flagged, even though I could pass all of my, you know, I could pass all my push-ups, my runs, my sit-ups, all of that was no problem. Well, it was a problem, but I passed it. If you're still not within that weight restriction.
The height weight ratio.
Which is basically modeled after white women. But if you're not fitting that white woman mold, you'll get flagged.
Yeah.
And there'll be things that you can't do until you lift this restriction. Wow. And I was just never meant, even though I was 100 pounds lighter than what I am now, I was like maybe 110 pounds lighter than what I am now. I was still not good enough. Which is why I was so glad to get out of the Army, because just not going to be good enough.
But you did 8 years, though. I mean, that's a strong, because,
that was the hardest 8 years of my life.
Because it's only required to, what, do four?
You're only required to do your initial enlistment, but you're obligated to the country for a full eight, whether you're active reserve or inactive reserve. So a lot of people get out and do inactive reserve, where you can call back.
Okay.
Or you can just go reserve and do 2 weeks.
Gotcha.
So I was like, I don't want y'all calling me if I, you know, I ain't fucking y'all like that. So I went reserve and did my little 2 weeks a year, 1 weekend a month. I did that up until the war started. So now I am a war veteran.
Wow.
Oh my God. Well, thank you for your service.
Thank you for your service. Yeah.
Thank you.
You do it.
Yeah.
Thank you for your service. So when did you move to New York? Because, I mean, I met you in the last, year or two? But you've been here forever, lighting up the city of New York.
I moved to New York in 2014, June 2014. My grandmother had passed, and the only reason I came, my original intention was to move to New York right after the Army. But my family needed me. So, you know, a family calls, you go with family. And my grandma died. I said, you know, I'm not going to stay here. I was like, if you gone, I'm gone. So after she passed in 2013, I gave myself a year to go and follow my dreams and live my life. Because I always kept saying, you know, my life would start when I moved to New York. Because up until then, I'd live for everybody else.
Yeah.
And after my grandma passed, I was like, okay, it's finally my turn.
Yeah.
To do the one thing nobody wanted me to do. Nobody thought I could do it. Nobody thought I deserved it. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, yeah.
And I moved here. I sold my car on a Saturday, flew here on a Sunday, and ain't left. I hustled hard when I got here. When I got here, I was basically on my savings. And I was like, okay, I'm going to rent this hostel in Chinatown and see what I can. I figured I could get a job, you know, pretty quickly. It's New York. So within 2 weeks, I had no job. I was like, okay, I got a problem. So I was looking, I was at the end of my money, and I was looking at having to come back to Atlanta. And I was like, that's not an option. Yeah. So I put out the call for help on Facebook. And one of my friends was like, Jessica Johnson. I remember Jessica Johnson. She went Navy though. No, Marine. She's Marine. But anyway, she says, I'm going to give you some information on shelters. I'm like, all right. I'm not leaving until I get what I want.
Right.
So I lived in shelters for almost a year.
Oh,
and
wow.
I just hustled it out. My friends in Atlanta, and I don't know if you remember Gerald Spann, a little crazy underclass. He was like, I used to live in New York, so go to this place and go to this place. So I flew here on Saturday, and by Tuesday morning, I was in Sugar Bar.
Like, now tell me, I know you had a residency at Sugar Bar. I know you had a residency recently at Groove before the pandemic struck. Right. And you were playing some other bars in the city. Tell me a little about that.
So I was doing open mic at the Ashford and Simpson Sugar Bar for some months, you know, several months. And Valerie Simpson says, well, Burgandy, when are you going to do a show? I'm like, one day. And she was like, okay, pick a day, go see Jimmy, pick a day, and let's get it started. So I was like, okay. And then months went by, and she was like, Burgundy, what happened to your show? I hadn't done it yet. And she was like, Jimmy, Burgundy's doing a show in blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, she's like, okay with you? I'm like, yes, ma'am. And that's how that started. And after that, it was just like, I could pick a day and like, hey, I want to do a show in this month. And we'll just do a date. And
that's amazing.
He comes to every single show I've had.
That's amazing to have a legend, have to have a legend like that support
you. For you? Yeah.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Now, has she become that of a mentor for you?
Yeah. When I was hospitalized in 2016, I think her call was probably the most important call I've had since for years. That was, yeah.
Really?
Broke me. I did not, people show kindness towards you, but you don't really take too much into it. I guess I didn't read far enough into it because she called my phone. And when she called my phone, I lost it.
Oh, man.
I lost it.
Yeah.
And she's such a huge inspiration. She really is.
Yeah. I mean, that's a great ally to have on your team. I mean, the stuff that she's done, the people she's met, and I mean, the songs she's written, all that
the
kind of stuff.
Created. Yeah.
As
yeah.
for the legacy, it's amazing. So for her to be vouching for you or to be reaching out to you is something that I think
that
many of
volume.
Us could, yeah, it speaks volumes.
Thank you. Mommy, I just put makeup on.
You know I love you, bro.
Rewind. You can't just skim over that. You were on the X Factor in the UK?
Uh-huh.
She said, like it was just something.
Right?
Like, I just went to Kroger.
Like a glass of water. That's amazing.
Yeah, it was like, it started as, I went to the UK to England for one reason, just to do like a scouting mission and try to see what kind of work I could drum up. And I had an unfortunate incident with someone who's going to be my manager, and things were turning bleak, and I was trying to figure a way out without, you know, having called somebody to say, come pick me up.
Right. Yeah.
And I got an invitation to audition, because I guess they saw me on Instagram since I was over there a lot. I was over there, you know, online a lot. So I ended up auditioning and ended up staying there for 4 months.
Oh, wow.
So I hustled there just like I hustled in New York. I was singing in pubs around the countryside. Had a couple gigs in Wales. And then started X Factor, and that was fun. It was TV, and I knew it was TV, and I took it as TV, so I didn't take it. I wasn't devastated but I made it the top 25. I'm proud of that.
That's amazing.
I would have made it further had other things had happened, but those were beyond my control.
With those type of shows, I mean, it's television.
Yeah.
And it's not always about talent, it's television. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of we as artists forget that. Although it's a talent show and it's about finding amazing talent, it's also still a TV show.
Right, yeah. It's firstly a TV show. Secondary, the actual participants come third or fourth. There are so many other things.
How are you? How are you faring in this pandemic? There's so much going on in the world. How are you dealing right now? How are you holding up?
Well, fortunately, I was already a homebody.
Yeah.
So I'm really good at being by myself because I am most of the time because it's New York. My apartment is on the 13th floor. I sit high above so I can judge people and walk by. So I'm doing pretty good. I've got my Xbox. I shoot people when I'm frustrated. It's all right. I started working on a project, so I'm trying to release my very first single that I wrote.
All right.
And I've already had it approved by Miss Simpson. So
yes.
She likes it. She likes it. I just have to get it mixed and mastered. And that's been the issue because I can't go. Where am I gonna go? Finding a engineer is
or difficult. And then having to if you have to trust who you're sending it to. So
yeah, I don't know who I'm sending it to. We don't speak the same language.
Yeah,
it's better if I can go into a studio. So now I'm just trying to find the right engineer to finish up the project. And it would have been a summer release, but I don't know what to do now. Okay, so I have been on the Apollo stage since 2009, back when I was still in Atlanta.
Oh, wow.
They held auditions one time at the Roxy.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and me and my boyfriend at the time went. And I got in And it was just like, okay, well, you got to come up to New York. And that was my first time coming to New York. So I came in for those, 2 days? Well, 2 or 3 days, and audition, got on. So I've been on and off, on and off. And then when I moved here, that first day I went to the Sugar Bar, the second day, because it was on a Thursday, I went to, I came on a Tuesday, and they said, you need to come on a Thursday, girl. You on the wrong night.
Yeah.
So I come to R&B night on Thursday, and I'm on stage singing, because I only got on stage. And guess who's sitting in the corner? Miss Kathy. The talent coordinator for the Apollo.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Oh, wow.
And I'm on stage. She said, Burgandy? Burgandy, what you doing here? I'm like, Miss Kathy? And she was like, oh, you coming back? You coming back? I was like, you know I'm coming back, too. I just got here. Finally, I never won first place until the very last competition where I won top dog.
Yeah.
And it was just a long time coming.
That's cool.
The little girl in me, the five-year-old, I got singled out a lot growing up in high school, in the Army. I got picked on a lot. Because they see my humble exterior, but they see a big black chick. And it was just like, ooh, a target, somebody I think I messed with. So I had a really, 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 really hard time. But I kept my passion hidden in my heart. So when I got out of high school, I joined the Army because that was what I was told I was expected to do. I got a government job. I worked for the IRS because I was expected to get a government job. I did everything I was expected to do, but I was miserable. Miserable. And this is the poorest I've ever been in my life right now. But it's the happiest I've ever been in my life.
Yeah.
It's funny because, you know, in society, we look at money and materialistic things as the pinnacle of happiness. Yeah. And sometimes the simplest of things bring us peace and happiness.
Some of the stuff that you just said, you know, how getting picked on or pushed, high school was really hard with stuff like that. Like, Atlanta ain't no joke. When it comes down to, if people feel a certain way, they gonna let you know. And they're basing it off what your exterior is and how you handle it and how you respond. Mm-hmm. You know, if your exterior is tough, they're gonna try you a little bit until you keep coming back at them, and then they'll let it go. But if you can't take that kind of stuff, man, I mean, people speak about bullying right now and what it all entails, but I don't think it's nothing matched to what we used to deal with back in the day.
The only difference between then and now is we fought, and nobody ever told us we couldn't fight.
Exactly.
We'd be like, let's take this outside. We'll see you after class.
You don't have too many two times you said that to me. Let's do it. Yeah, like you said, everything's
going to be more. Meet me at the school bus. I'll see you at bus stop. That's all it was. But now these kids are now, you know, they're just online bullying, make people cry online. And
exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And it's crazy because I used to it was easier when you could just choke your bully in the hallway closet.
You said choke.
These kids don't have that kind of access. You know what I'm saying?
Wait, did you say I'm weak? Wait, you said choke your bully.
My bullies didn't last long.
Do you have a favorite artist that inspired you to go on the journey?
My entire life was built around Whitney Houston.
Whitney Houston, my God, what a voice.
My whole life was built around her. I auditioned to sing for my graduation. and Whitney had done the she had sung the national anthem, the Star Spangled Banner.
Okay,
yeah. He had just done that, and I was channeling my best Whitney.
Yeah,
and I didn't think it's my graduation.
Yeah.
But that was an accomplishment right there. That was the only reason I ain't drop out of school, because I wanted to sing.
Let's hold on that a little bit.
I had to stay in school. I'm a Gemini, baby. I got sides. There's layers to this.
You got layers. So you just had a birthday. Happy belated to you, then.
Happy belated.
Thank you very much. She, okay, yeah. So Whitney Houston was my first love. Mm-hmm. My second love is Aretha Franklin.
Yeah.
My my grandmother, her best friend, used to have arguments over Patty versus Aretha.
Oh.
And I'd be sitting at the table like this, trying to figure out what the hell they was talking about. You can't put them two together.
They're not the same.
You can't pit them against each other, because that's perfection on one side and perfection on the other side.
It is.
You gotta take them as a set. And so, like, I refuse to pick a side. So the idea to do an Aretha Franklin tribute came when I was still overseas. And I had created a band, and we had put together a show. Well, I didn't create a band. We found a band who was one of the local bands in the, wherever he lives. Can't remember now. But, yeah, so I ended up getting with this band, and we rehearsed and rehearsed and rehearsed, and then I got swindled and sideswiped by my manager and never got to do the show. So by the time I got back to the States, I was like, I still want to do it. I learned all of the songs, and I asked Miss Simpson, I was like, what do you think about me doing an Aretha tribute? And she was like, pick a date.
Yeah.
And that was it. I did a series of them. They were sold out. Every show was sold out.
That's amazing.
Every single show. And she said I was the first person to ever pack out my own personal shows.
Do you have anything specially coming up, or something that people can look forward to hearing about maybe in the near future?
Yes. Yes. Please go to my website and follow me at burgandysings.com. So when I finally finish this single, somebody's going to have to listen to it. So there you go.
Perfect. Perfect. And then, so you gave us your website or whatnot, burgandysings.com. Do you have an Instagram they can follow you on, or Twitter or anything like that?
My Instagram is Burg is here, B-U-R-G-I-S-H-E-R-E. All the links to my social media is on the website, burgandysings.com. From there, you can get to my Instagram. I have two Instagrams. So you can get to my Instagram. You can get to my, what's that yellow thing with the ghost on it? Snapchat.
Snapchat.
Snapchat. Funny story behind my Instagram.
Come on, tell us.
So we were doing the show. We were filming for X Factor, and we were finally going to do the first. They were finally airing my first audition. So the day they aired it, someone got my Instagram shut down, so I couldn't get any new followers.
Uh-oh. But why is that though?
I can only speculate, but let's just say it's a lot of haters in this world. Everybody was getting all these followers left and right because, you know, the episode aired.
Right.
And I had no Instagram all of a sudden.
Wow.
And it was like, it simultaneously with them airing my episode, I was on my Instagram and then it shut down. And I didn't get my Instagram page back, my original page back, until a year later.
Ooh.
Oh, wow.
Very suspicious.
Yep.
You lost all the momentum at this point.
Mm-hmm. So I had to create this other one, which sounds like, well, I guess I'll keep it.
Yeah.
But there's the story of my Instagram.
So
Burgundy and Burg is here. So there you go.
Leave us with this. What is something that people wouldn't ordinarily know about you? I mean, obviously we know that you were a soldier before, so that's something that's like, wow. But it, what can you leave us with? It's like, oh, this is something that no one would ever really figure this out, and I don't mind telling.
Something cool has helped about me. That I died before?
You what?
Oh, yeah. I died before.
Oh, yeah. Hold up. Wait a minute.
Rewind. You can't just keep dropping these bombs and not
on them. Matter of fact,
I've had a very interesting life. It was actually when my sophomore year in high school, I broke my arm. Was it my junior? No, my junior year in high school, I broke my arm playing with my sibling on a bunk bed. And sometime during the surgery, the anesthesia wore off, and I woke up during surgery. And I remember hearing them say, "Oh shit!" Da, 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 da. And next thing I know, I'm shivering. My whole body's like seizing on a cold metal cart.
Oh,
and my
wow.
feet are vibrating on the edge of the cart, so my heel hurts. And I'm freezing cold. And ironically, because it was at Grady, my grandmother worked at Grady. She was at work. She was upstairs at work, and they didn't even tell her I was out of surgery, so they didn't tell her I was sick. I don't know what they were waiting on. But when I was convulsing and I was coming away, right when I woke up, everything was all weird, you know? And I could barely move, but I could move my head, and the lady opened the door. A nurse opened the door, and I said, "I'm cold," but they had thrown, putting the thing down my throat, so you couldn't really.
Couldn't hear you.
Couldn't really talk. So she looked at me and freaked out. Like, I legit scared her. So apparently when anesthesia wears off, if you're still in surgery, they hit you, you know. They weren't prepared, they overdid it.
So how has the pandemic affect you with the coronavirus and everything going on? Like, how has it affected your livelihood, your family? Is everyone okay? Is everyone healthy and safe?
Well, actually, it's been kind of up and down when it comes to my family because, well, we found out that my nephew, I found out after he was put on the ventilator that he tested positive and was on a ventilator for a couple of weeks, I think maybe 2 weeks. And then he came out. I think they sedated him. Mm-hmm. And when he finally came through and came out, I found out after the fact. But it's real. You know, it's real out here. And I've had a couple of bandmates that have passed away. My nephew was only 13. So for people saying, oh, it's not real, it's real. And kids can get it.
Yeah, it's very real. It's very, very real. Yeah.
It's terrifying.
A lot of people are not making it through. What's the guy that from Broadway that just passed away?
Nick Cordero. Yeah. Was in ICU and ventilators, and they amputated his leg because of blood clots. He was in the hospital. Was it 98 days, 94 days, something like that?
That many days?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. And then there was things turned around for the good, for the bad, for the good, and then it flipped the other way around. And I think the last time I was seeing on the news, they were going to have a surgery on his lungs. Something was wrong with his lungs.
Yeah, there was a blood clot or something.
Yeah, and then unfortunately he transitioned. That took me out.
You now have your sights set on Broadway. It's like, what brought that about? Was that something that you've always wanted to do, or was it something that later on you were just like, oh, I kind of feel like I want to do that? Because I saw that on one situation that we had a link with you playing with Chad, Handsome Chaz rather. Handsome Chaz playing I'm Here, and I know you did at the Apollo, you did And I'm Telling You. Is musical theater something that you've always wanted to do, or let me know?
Actually, yes. Music theater has always been something I wanted to do ever since high school, and ever since I saw my first episode of Fame. And then I ended up in performing arts high school, which was just like,
Yeah, of course.
I saw my very first commercial of cats, I think, when I was maybe 4 or 5. And I was like, first of all, I want a cat. Second, I want to be a cat. Third of all, I want to go see that. So I didn't get to be a cat. I did get a kitten eventually. But my first time seeing a cat as an adult was like probably the most annoying experience anybody else has ever had, because I sang the entire show the whole time.
Oh, wow.
Well, I have a lot of life goals, and there's very few of them that I've yet to fulfill. One is performing a Broadway show. I've done off-Broadway with Jesus Christ Superstar Gospel.
You did that with Darren Williams?
Wait. Hold on. You did Jesus Christ Superstar Gospel?
Yeah. With Darren Williams. Now, you know, So, Kwame, you know that's the one that Darren Williams was workshopped beforehand with Louis St. Louis, as well as Kathleen.
Of course I know that. I was a part of the original workshop for that.
Yeah. It's so great. You made me smile tonight. I loved it. I got to tell my mama I found a classmate.
Oh, your mama's so proud.
Yeah. I'm like, man, she went there. She actually went there while you was there.
So. Yeah.
Well, on behalf of Upward and Onward Productions, we'd like to thank you for hanging out with us for the show. Now, your attention and time is much appreciated, and we look forward to seeing you next time. Remember, success is only an arm's length away. Upward and Onward, folks.